the Supreme Court has said we might recognize another category, but the state would have to show evidence of a historical forbidding of this sort of speech. And of course, that doesn't exist with revenge porn. The state comes in and says, well, these 38 states have passed revenge porn statutes. Well, that's fine, but they've all done it within the last decade. That's not a historical pattern. What the court's talking about in terms in the history context is they're talking about, you know, this is the sort of speech that was forbidden in 1789. 1791.
Right.
Right. There, when the Constitution was written or when the Bill of Rights was written, well, you know, what was the state of the law then?
Then why did the state keep saying that, well, in the Alvarez case Stevens. Mm-hmm. And they also the Reed town versus right. town of Gilbert. Why did they keep saying that, well, then in the opinions it came out with a strict scrutiny analysis, and they used that balancing or that test to do because so. Why were they?
I have a secret that? For you.
All right.
Most lawyers, including prosecutors and judges, don't understand free speech law very well. So they're doing the best they can.
Half this table doesn't understand it very well.
Yeah,
I can tell you that.
It's the two of us at the corner. Fascinating. I mean,
it's a very we don't really learn it in law school. Right?
No, you don't. The general public doesn't understand. How much have we seen over the last year with the NFL protests that people think that the NFL is somehow violating people's free speech by not allowing them to protest or not signing them? I mean,
I would say that lawyers understand it a little bit better than the general public, but just a little bit. So the prosecutor makes these arguments because prosecutor has to make arguments. I think that was the case where their brief didn't cite any Supreme Court case more recent than 1989. And so in my reply brief, did somebody forget to pay for the subscription to the Supreme Court reporters on this, for this? Because there have been developments, right? 2010, there was Stevens. 2012, there was Alvarez. These are huge, huge First Amendment cases that pretty much define the way that the Supreme Court will, at least until things change, will review free speech challenges.
Yesterday, the prosecutor mentioned one case that dealt with content-based restrictions, and it was from the 70s. So I think that in my case, they didn't really talk about, other than to say that Alvarez doesn't apply, they didn't really talk about Stevens or Alvarez or any of those.